Brothers and sisters, good morning, welcome. Let's all stand together. Good to be in the house of the Lord together. Raise our voices. Come all you weary, sing it out.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
There is only one. Our God will save. We believe, we believe. Let the lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. The love in vain, let the church live loud. Our God will save. We believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail for the power of God. His arms fail now. Church, it is child dedication weekend, so if you are a family or prayer partner who's dedicating a child, you can make your way up to the stage now. Everyone else, you can take a seat.
Brielle, hey, you want to say hi? Hey, look.
Look.
Oh, Mom made really good cakes for me. So, starting out, it was just kind of everything so exciting. Oh, the music is so fun. I like doing coloring. I like talking to my table teacher. I like seeing all the other kids that are my friends. And Mars, then I started really realizing how cool Jesus was and taking that faith from my parents and learning to make it my own and wrestling with it and asking hard questions. Being in that community with so many people pouring into me every week, every year. It's kept me on the right path, and it's been such an encouragement in my walk with God. Carrie, I can't thank you enough for all your patient and kind leadership. Cincy, thank you for always showing us also how we can love the rest of the world. Thank you to all my BBS leaders, my table leaders throughout the years. Thank you, Mark, for the fruit roll-ups. Thank you, Alyssa and Rachel and Teacher Chad. To Mom and Dad for telling me to make the most of my moments, to seek hard after God more than anything else in life.
Will you as a congregation commit yourselves to glorifying God by seeking to present Dan and Natalie and Gabrielle complete in Christ by praying for them, ministering to them, and encouraging them in their spiritual journey?
We will.
Thank you, everyone who's sitting in that room 18 years ago that promised to walk with me through my faith journey. You've made good on your promise, and now I get to be a part of that promise too.
Part of following Jesus isn't just to follow him, it's also to be kind to other people. So that's why we can do things like give people.
Good morning. My name is Megan Keel. I'm our kids director here, and we are so excited to get to celebrate with 24 families that are dedicating their kids this weekend. We call these weekends child dedications, but really another name could be parent commitments, because it's an opportunity for the parents to make a commitment to raise their kids in a way that is honoring to God, so that hopefully and prayerfully one day their kids will make that choice to follow Jesus for themselves. Before Child Dedication Weekend, all of our families participate in a class where they learn more about the biblical foundation of child dedication, what that looks like here at Lincoln Berean, as well as talking about how they are the primary disciple makers of their kids and how we hope that that is a joy and an opportunity to get to do so. However, that is not something that we desire for parents to walk through alone. We want to be a church that comes alongside our families, our kids, to support them, to pray for them, to serve them, and to invest in their lives. I've said this many times before, but I've been so grateful for the way that this church has loved and cared for my own two boys, and I've loved my family so well. And I desire that each family that calls Lincoln Berean home would feel that same way. So now I'm going to read a couple commitments to our parents and give them an opportunity to respond. And then afterwards, I'm going to read a commitment for us as a church body to give us an opportunity to respond to as well. So parents, will you commit your child to God, committing to raise them according to God's truth and to do all you can to help them come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ? Will you seek to model a relationship with Jesus for your child by passionately pursuing God yourself? Will you seek to parent with grace and truth so that you can model the loving and caring relationship God desires with them? And will you commit to regularly pray for your child that as they grow, they might come to know and do the will of God by the power of the Holy Spirit? Parents, if you agree with those commitments, will you please respond with, "We will." Like I mentioned before, these weekends are just a reminder of the part that we all have to play in coming alongside our families. This morning and every Sunday, we have over 500 kids that are joining us in our kids' ministry that are excited and ready to learn more about Jesus. And so we want to invite you to prayerfully consider what that might look like for you personally to come alongside our families. For some, it might mean adjusting your Sunday morning schedule to be able to attend church one service and serve during the other service. It might mean intentionally praying for the kids and the families that are here. Or it might mean getting to invest in a deep way with the families that are in your spheres, whether that's a class or a life group or other places that God might have you. And so we would love to, at this time, to make a commitment for that too. So will you, as a church family, commit to support our parents and children in whichever way God may lead you? If you are ready to make that commitment and able, will you respond with, "We will"? Great, thanks. So at this time, we're going to have a slideshow play that'll have photos of all the kids that are being dedicated this weekend. Parents, after the service, you can stop by the spotlight booth to grab a gift for your child. Prayer partners, you can gather around your families and start praying, and then once you're done, you can find your seat.
Thank you.
fun getting to see all the pictures of those kids, each one of them deeply known and deeply loved by God. As we continue with our worship service this morning, I have a few announcements that I wanted to share. First, if you are a guest visiting with us or are newer to Lincoln Berean, we would love for the chance to get to meet you. You can stop by any of our info centers after the service and someone will be there to chat with you, or we invite you to join in Belong. Belong is a great space to meet staff, learn more about our ministries and what we believe here at Lincoln Berean, as well as a spot to ask any questions you might have and learn more about different ways to be involved. Belong takes place on the first and third Sunday of each month in room E202 at 10:30 a.m. So we invite you to come back next week to join in there. VBS is now just 2 months away, and we are so excited for that week. This year's theme is called Start the Party, and isn't it so true? We have so much to celebrate with Jesus. We're excited to get to talk about him all week long and to celebrate the good news of Jesus with kids. VBS is for kids that are going into preschool up through sixth grade. It's June 18th through the 21st from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. And it's $10 a kid or $30 for a family max. Every year we have over 800 kids that join us for VBS. So it is such a fun time. But that brings me to my next part about VBS is volunteers. As you can imagine, it takes a lot of people serving to help VBS happen every year. And I am praising God because we have over 200 people that have signed up already to be a part of VBS. And even with that, we need about 200 more. So we want to invite you to come and serve with us at VBS. There's a variety of different roles, from leading a small group of kids, about 6 to 8 kids in a small group, getting to be a one-on-one buddy, serving with our craft team or our games team, helping with greeting and security and setup and cleanup and Friday night fam jam. There's a lot of different opportunities. So we would love, if you're able, for you to come and serve with us. Signups for both kids and serving are up on our website, they're on the app, or you can stop by the spotlight booth after the service, and I'd love to help get you signed up. If you know whether your kids are going to attend VBS or if you're able to serve, we would love for you to sign up as soon as possible. I'm a planner, and as you can imagine, there's a lot of planning that goes into VBS, and we want to be good stewards of our resources in purchasing t-shirts and the crafts and all the supplies that are needed for VBS, and so we'd love to have you sign up as soon as possible. Lastly, if you would like to join this weekend in worship through giving, there's a few ways that you can do that, and you can find them on the screens. Would you join me in prayer? Father, we are so grateful for you, God, for your love, for your care, God, for intimately knowing each one of us. God, I'm thankful for this space that we have to gather together as a church body to worship you, to praise you, God, to learn more about you through your word. And I pray, God, that this morning, that our hearts would be open to you, to receiving whatever you may have for us. God, I pray that through the message that we would be drawn closer to you, God. And as we leave this morning, that we would continue to be lights in this world. God, I'm so grateful for all of the kids and the families that were a part of child dedication this weekend. God, I pray for the kids that as they grow up, that they may come to know you, God, that they would give their life to you, that they would trust in you, God. And I pray for their parents. Parenting is hard, and God, I just pray that they would lean on you through every situation. God, I pray too that they have a community that would come alongside them to pray for them, to support them, and to walk through their parenting journey with them. God, I'm so grateful for the many churches all across Lincoln that are gathering this weekend. We pray for Grace Chapel, for their staff, for their congregation, that they too, God, would continue to serve you, would continue to be lights in their neighborhoods and their workplaces, wherever you have placed them, God, that they would continue to point people towards you. God, we're so grateful for your generosity, and just God, we pray for this offering. Lord, I think about all the different ways that it is used to draw people closer to you, one of them being BBS, to draw kids closer to you. And so, God, we pray for this offering, that it would bring you honor and glory. We love you and pray all this in your Son's name. Amen. Would you please stand as we continue to worship the Lord?
Jesus, we know our world. from my knees I lift this prayer to my Savior. For my life and for the world, you're the answer, Jesus.
Thank you for worshiping with us. You may have a seat.
Kingdom stories. The kingdom stories of Jesus reveal to us what the kingdom of God is like. And most often, these stories come to us in the form of a parable. So for the next 7 weeks, we are looking at some of the parables of Jesus in hopes that he will teach us what living in the one true kingdom is like. The kingdom was the primary message of Jesus. He starts his ministry by saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven," or the kingdom of God, "is at hand." It's here right now. In Matthew, Jesus refers to the kingdom 32 times. In Luke and other gospels, it comes up 65 times. In Acts, Peter and Stephen and Paul take it as their full mission to preach the kingdom of God and salvation in the name of Jesus. So I love this series just as much as Ryan, probably, because I love to talk about the kingdom and I love to study parables. And parables can be challenging for us, right? So we're going to look at some things prior to it in just a minute. Ryan covered some short parables, several of them, last week. Today we're going to get into some longer, what I call story form parables. And because they can be challenging, I want to share a few study helps, maybe some cliff notes with you before we start. There are several reasons that parables are more challenging for us to understand than for the original hearers. First one is this: Jesus uses examples or concepts or ideas from their culture, and their culture was really different than ours. So it's hard for us to understand the examples he's using. And it's important that we try to look at the story and hear it the way the original hearers would have heard it from their perspective, right? Secondly, we need to determine who is the main audience that Jesus is speaking to. Who's he talking to? Is he talking to his disciples only? Is he talking to the crowds? Is he talking to the Pharisees, the Sadducees? Or maybe it's all of those groups at the same time, because sometimes that's what it is. We need to understand who is the audience, because it will help us understand the message that Jesus is trying to convey. And then thirdly, the parables were an oral storytelling device. Jesus spoke these stories to people. They weren't written down for the original hearers. They were written down for us and for others who would come to study and look at them later. But when you listen to someone tell you a story, it's very different. Your experience is different than if you're reading it on a page. Often, when you are listening to a good storyteller, like Jesus, you get drawn in. And that was part of his intent, was to draw people into the story and then call forth a response from them. And then usually these stories have a twist, a turning point, somewhere, something that happens that's unexpected that catches them off guard. And that is a good place to look for the meaning of what Jesus is trying to say. A parable works similar to the way a joke works, right? The whole point of a joke, what makes it funny, if you find it funny, is that the hearer has an immediacy with what's being told. It's funny to the hearer precisely because he or she gets caught, gets set up, as it were. But it can only catch them off guard if they understand what we would call the points of reference for the joke. If I have to interpret the joke to you, to explain why it's funny, then it's like saying, "Well, I guess you had to be there." Meaning, if I have to interpret the joke to you, you now understand what you should have laughed at, but it didn't affect you the way it was supposed to. I'll give you an example. One joke. Why did the clock in the cafeteria always run slow? Why did the clock in the cafeteria always run slow? Anybody know the answer to this? You can shout it out. Because every lunch, it went back for seconds. A lot of groans. This is the way my kids react to my jokes. Okay? But here's why, whether you liked it or not, the reason you understood it was because you identified with a couple of points of reference. First of all, you were thinking about a clock that's running, that's telling time, and probably you thought about it on a cafeteria wall. That's the second point of reference, a cafeteria. So you were thinking of a clock that's behind in telling time, but the joke caught you off guard because it's a play on words for the idea of going back for seconds, like second helpings in the cafeteria, or going back 4 seconds of time, right? If you don't understand the points of reference, if you don't catch them, then you will miss the joke. It won't make any sense. The unexpected turn won't happen for you because the points of reference are what create the ordinary expectations. They're what's setting you up. So in a parable, it works the same way. We need to be looking for what the original hearers would have identified with and how they would have identified with it. Otherwise, we'll completely miss the point. So I'm going to try to point out points of reference for you as we go through these three parables. We're going to be in Luke chapter 15 this morning. And if you want to open up your Bible, if you want to pull it up on your phone, you are welcome to do that. Or if you would like to just hear the parable, parables, the way maybe the original hearers heard it, I invite you to do that as well. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 3. Now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near to him to listen to him, to Jesus. Both the Pharisees and the scribes began to grumble, saying, "This man receives sinners and he eats with them." So he told them this parable. So right away, Luke is helping us out with number two of the helpful hints, right? He's telling us who the audience is and why Jesus tells this parable. He says, all of the tax collectors and sinners, when you hear sinners, think irreligious Jews, okay? Meaning Jews who didn't follow the purity laws to make themselves clean again. They didn't care about those things, so they were considered unclean. They were sinners is like a nickname for them. It's just a way of referring to them. These are the people that are gathering close to Jesus to listen to him. See, throughout the ministry and of Jesus, and particularly in the Gospel of Luke, if you were to look through it, Jesus consistently demonstrates his love, his care, his commitment to the poor, to the outsiders. He heals the sick, he heals the blind, he heals the lame, he spends time, he eats with tax collectors like Levi, like Zacchaeus. He connects with Samaritans, and not just Samaritans, which would have been bad enough, but Samaritan lepers. In Luke, I think it's chapter 17, he spends time with Samaritan lepers, somebody no one would have wanted to come in contact with for fear of contacting leprosy and being unclean for the rest of your life. These are the people that Jesus is calling, teaching, inviting into his kingdom. And the Pharisees and the scribes don't like that. They begin to grumble, we're told, saying, this man receives sinners. He accepts them. He allows them to be in his presence. He allows them to come close to him, actually eats with them, share table fellowship, which was something you did not do if you wanted to remain pure and clean and be able to go to temple. So here's our audience. Sinners and tax collectors, or we could just use the term outcasts as a whole group over here, who are flocking to Jesus to hear him teach. And Pharisees and scribes who are opposed to Jesus because he is embracing the outcasts. This is the audience. Jesus is going to tell stories that speak to both of them at the same time. Verse 3. So he told them a parable, saying, what man among you, if he has 100 sheep and has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open pasture and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my lost sheep. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous ones who need no repentance. Or what woman among you, if she has 10 silver coins and loses one coin, does not light a lamp, Sweep the house, search carefully everywhere until she finds it. And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin which I had lost." In the same way, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Now, notice, how does Jesus start these stories? What man among you or what woman among you? He's appealing to what they knew to be true. Another way of saying it would be, you know this is what you would do. If you had 100 sheep and one of them wandered off and became lost, you would leave the 99 in the open pasture and you would go after that one sheep that was lost. And when you found it, you would rejoice. And then when you came home, you would call together your friends and your neighbors and you would throw a huge party to celebrate that you had found your lost sheep. Or what woman among you? You know this is true. If she had 10 coins and lost one, wouldn't light a lamp, sweep the house, search everywhere for the lost coin, and when she finds it, she calls together her friends, her neighbors, and throws a party to celebrate. So what are the points of reference here? We have one sheep that's lost among 100, one coin that's lost amongst 10, and huge celebrations, parties when they are found. Now, in telling these stories, these two, Jesus isn't saying anything new to them. These are what we might call, of course you would, stories for them. When they heard these stories, I think they were all nodding their heads, saying, yep, that's exactly what I would do. Of course you would leave the 99 sheep and go after the one that's lost. Of course you would sweep the house and search for your one lost coin out of 10. That's how they thought, how they lived in their culture. It's not necessarily how we think or live in our culture. If I have 100 sheep and somehow I figure out, someone tells me, hey, one of your sheep is gone. That's just one. I got 99 more. Let's just call it a loss. We don't need to worry about that one lost sheep. I still got 99. Or if I had 10 coins and lost one of them, I still got 90%. 90%'s an A. We don't need to worry about the other 10%. See, that tends to be how we think in our culture. It's not how they thought in their culture. They would have gone after that one lost sheep. They would have searched for the one lost coin because they understood how valuable those things are. And the twist comes when Jesus says after each story. He says almost the same statement twice. He compares the party thrown for the lost sheep or the lost coin to the party that's thrown in heaven when one sinner repents. He's saying the Father and the angels, they say, start the party when a sinner repents, when they change their mind about God, when they start to move towards God. The joy in heaven is greater than any party you could ever throw for a lost sheep or a lost coin. And see, Jesus is speaking to both groups at the same time, outcasts and Pharisees, and he's again indicating to the outcasts that they are welcome in the kingdom. But Jesus isn't done yet. He's about to throw another twist their way in the next story. Verse 11, and he said, a man had two sons. So we're going to stop right there for just a minute. Here's our points of reference. There is a father, a man, who has two sons. Now, I think that when the people listening to this story heard that statement, just right at the beginning, I think they would have likely begun to think in their minds, some of them, about the patriarchs from the history of Israel. We can't know for sure what was in their minds. But these people, even the sinners and tax collectors, when they were really young boys, Jewish boys and girls, they would have been taught the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Jewish scriptures of our Old Testament. They would have not just been taught it, they probably, some of them, would have become masters at it. Because as a young Jewish child, many of them had memorized the Pentateuch, the first five books, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, memorized. Because that's how important it was to the Jewish people to teach their children about their history, about the scriptures, about who God was, about what he had said. So I think when they hear this statement that says a man had two sons, I think for some of them, they begin to think about, well, Adam had two sons, Cain and Abel. Abraham had two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. Isaac had two sons, Esau and Jacob. And here's what they knew about these particular pairings. It was the younger of the two sons that received the primary blessing, despite the fact that the culture in that day said that the older son was supposed to receive the primary blessing and the majority of the inheritance. In fact, that pattern for Israel continues throughout its history. Joseph, who's like, I think he's the 11th of Jacob's 12 sons. He actually, when the blessing comes from Jacob at the end of his life, he receives double the blessing. Here's why. Because Jacob, when he's blessing his sons, he blesses each of Joseph's sons, his two grandsons. So they receive double. It happens with David. He is the youngest of seven when they come to anoint the king from this family. But they've forgotten about him. He's not even around. He's out in the field still. They had to call him in. He is not the one you would think to become king. It's not like the first couple of sons that are strong and big and bold and warriors. And it happens with Solomon, who is the second child of David with Bathsheba. He's the one who becomes the king. All Jewish people knew to identify with the younger son. So let's see what happens next. A man had two sons, verse 11. The younger of them, I think everyone's thinking, oh, this will be a good story. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. So he divided his wealth between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country. And there he squandered his estate with loose living. Now, when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country and he began to be impoverished. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country. And that guy sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating, and no one was giving anything to him. So there's a twist. The younger son turns out not to be like righteous Abel or faithful Isaac or clever Jacob. He's not even strategic David or wise Solomon. He turns out to be irresponsible, selfish, self-indulgent, reckless, and only living for the next party. This is not how it's supposed to go. This is not how the story is supposed to go. Most scholars agree that when the younger son asks his father for his inheritance, it is a huge insult. It's like saying to him, I wish you were dead. Just give me what's mine. And when the father actually divides his wealth between them, it's not as though this is in cash or the currency of the day. The way wealth was accumulated in that culture was either through land or livestock or servants. And so it takes a couple of days for the younger son to sell this stuff off, convert it to currency so that he can go on his adventure. This might have been land that had been in the family for generations. So a further insult. Think about for a minute the relational, emotional temperature that's going on in the family as he's working to get this stuff so he can take it with him. Perhaps the father is hoping he will reconsider, change his mind about his request. Perhaps the older brother is exulting in his newfound wealth, or maybe more likely, he is probably frustrated that his father has once again indulged the ridiculous request of his younger brother. Again, we can't know what's going on in their hearts, their minds, but I think it was probably a tense couple of days. And the younger son goes off to a distant country, and we're told that he squanders his wealth through loose living to the point where he gets a job feeding pigs. And he imagines, he's so hungry, he imagines himself eating the slop that he is giving to these pigs. Now, before we go on, I want you to notice one more difference in this story. It's not following exactly the same pattern as the previous two. There doesn't appear to be any seeking of the one who is lost. The father just lets him go. Let's read on, verse 17. But when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread, but I am dying here with hunger? I will get up, go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men.'" So he got up, came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, felt compassion for him, ran to him, kissed him, embraced him, and the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am not worthy to be called your son." But the father's not listening. He says to his slaves, "Quick, bring out the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet, bring the fattened calf, kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." And they started the party. The son comes to his senses. He decides to return to his father's house and have his father make him a hired hand. He's got an entire speech rehearsed, we can see. Heads towards the father's house, and then notice verse 20. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him, had compassion for him, ran to him, kissed him, embraced him. I said earlier, just a few minutes ago, there doesn't appear to be any seeking of the one who was lost. But I think this father was seeking his lost son in a way that was appropriate to a relationship. The idea that he sees him from a long way off implies that the father was watching, hoping for his son to return. I don't think it's random that just on the day he happened to look down the road, well, that's the day his son comes walking home. I think probably every day he stopped and he would go look down that road, hoping to see his son's familiar gait. Probably multiple times a day. Maybe every time he walked by that place on his estate and could look down the road, he glanced, hoping. And that part of the parable comes to an end, the same as the others. The lost son comes home. There is rejoicing. There is a celebration. There is a huge party. But here's the twist. Remember, I said that the first two parables were, "Of course you would," stories. Everyone was listening, nodding their heads. Of course you would go after the one lost sheep. Of course you would search for the one lost coin. The story of the lost son is not an "of course you would" story for them. It's an "of course you wouldn't" story all the way through for them. I think as the people were listening to this story, their mouths might have been hanging open a little bit. I think many of them were shaking their heads and saying to themselves, "No, of course this wouldn't happen. No way. Of course a son would never ask his father for the inheritance early. That would be such an insult. But if it did, of course the father wouldn't indulge him by giving it to him. That would be foolish. It would be like allowing him to bring shame upon the family. But if he did, then of course the son wouldn't go and sell it off and convert it and wander off and run away to a distant land and squander it. That's not what the younger son, the son of blessing, is supposed to. It's not how he's supposed to act. But if it did happen, of course that son wouldn't ever, ever think of coming back. Because he would not be welcomed. But the son has no other options. And if he does come back, of course he wouldn't be accepted back. The son knows he's not going to be accepted. That's why he has a speech rehearsed. But the father leaves the house, runs to him, meets him. And the listeners are thinking again, no, this wouldn't happen. Of course he didn't run. Because to run in that culture was undignified. I mean, you had to grab the bottom of your robes and tuck them into your belt, and your legs were exposed. And older men and women, elders of the family, of the city, whoever, they did not do this. Running was something you had servants to do for you. So, of course, that didn't happen. But if the father did leave the house and he did go to meet the son, of course, there wouldn't be reconciliation. No way that could happen. But all of that happens in Jesus' story. And I think they would have just been flabbergasted, shaking their heads, wondering, what happens next? See, the story's not over, verse 25. Now, the older son. Okay, so remember, there were two sons. We haven't heard anything about this guy since the very beginning. Now, his older son was in the field. And when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing, and he summoned one of the servants and began asking, inquiring what these things could be. And he said to him, your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound. But he became angry and was not willing to go in. And his father came out and began pleading with him. But he answered and said to his father, look, for so many years I've been serving you, and I have never neglected a command of yours, and yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. And he said to him, son, you've always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live and was lost and has been found. See, the older son, the older brother is not happy that his brother has returned or that everyone's celebrating this fact. He's angry. And he refuses to go into the party. And I think at this point, the father realizes he has two lost sons. And so the father does for this son what he did for the other son. He does what the same thing the shepherd does with the lost sheep or the woman with the lost coin. He leaves the house, goes out to his son, whom he loves, and he pleads with him and comforts him and urges him to come in and rejoice with them. I want you to notice the language in this conversation. The older son cannot even bring himself to use the term brother. He calls him this son of yours, I think with a sneer. And the father's response is specific. He starts with his response actually with the word child. Now, most translations, including the one I'm reading this morning, say son, but the actual Greek term is child. It's a term of endearment. It communicates how much he cares for this son. And then he says to him, you have always been with me. All that is mine is yours, which technically that point is correct. Right? This son had never been lost, at least not in the way that the younger son was lost. But it's clear that what the father felt and what the son felt were two different things. The son felt like a slave in the father's house, never neglecting a command. His complaint, it's not about relationship, it's about, hey, you've never given me supplies for a party. He completely misses the depth of his father's love. And the parable ends here with no specific resolution. We don't know whether the older son ever goes into the party or not. So, what do these stories teach us about the kingdom? And what do they teach us about the king? See, there's no mention of kingdom anywhere in this chapter, but we are studying it. It was included because we would tend to say, well, one-third of his stories and Jesus' primary message is the kingdom. There must be things for us to understand. He's trying to teach us about the kingdom. So let's start with this. What do these kingdom stories teach? What do these stories teach us about the kingdom? I think a couple of things. Who's the kingdom for? Who's invited in? Go back to the beginning of who's listening to the story. You have sinners and tax collectors, outcasts, and the Pharisees and the scribes. And Jesus is inviting them both in. See, the younger brother represents the outcast. The older brother represents the Pharisees and the scribes. And Jesus is saying, all of us need to come back, need to be invited in. The kingdom is for those who are lost. Who's lost? How much of the world is lost? Glenn Packiam says it this way. When Jesus starts to tell the first story, 1 out of 100 are lost. So 1% of the world is lost. But then he tells the second story, and it's 1 out of 10. So 10% of the world is lost. But then as he begins to tell the third story, it's 1 out of 2 brothers that is lost. So 50% of the world is lost. But as he continues, we realize actually the other brother is lost too. So 100% of the world is lost. Outcast, Pharisees, everyone in between needs Jesus, like we just sang. All of us need to be led back to the kingdom of God. How do we enter? How do we enter the kingdom? Well, according to these stories, through repentance. Twice, right, Jesus tells us that there's rejoicing that happens when one sinner, one lost person repents, which is a little bit strange for him to say after those first stories about sheep and coins because neither of those things can repent. What's he doing? He's setting us up for the third story in which the younger son leaves the father's house in rebellion and is lost, and then he comes to his senses. That's repentance. And he comes back to the father's house and he says, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. The father describes this son as being dead and has begun to live. He was lost and has been found. He says it twice. What do I mean by repentance? Well, we chatted about this briefly in the Rethink series. Right after Christmas, the Greek word is metanoeo, which means to change your mind, to think differently about life, about God. And if you begin to think differently, then you will begin to live differently. That's what the younger son did. He changed his mind about what the father was like and what life was like in the father's house. And he decided he didn't know the best way to live his life. He had tried to be his own God, to live life on his own, to do it his way. And all that brought was misery. And so he decided to come back to the father's house. He had tried to do it his own way, we would say by being really bad, squandering, loose living, squandering his life. And that didn't work. But see, the older son had tried to be his own God also. Tried to do life his own way, we would say by being really good, never neglecting a command, slaving away for his father. And it appears that the older son would not repent or change his mind about the father or his brother or the party. Repentance means to change your mind about who the king is and what life is like in the kingdom. And maybe you've never understood that till this morning. Maybe today is the day for you to say to God, I've tried to live life on my own. Tried to do it my own way without you, God. And I don't want to do that anymore. I need you, Lord, to show me how to live my life your way in your kingdom. I need you to forgive me for living it my way, doing it on my own without you. And I ask you to lead me into your kingdom. Maybe that's you today. Or maybe you're like me. I asked Jesus to do that a long time ago. I've been following Jesus for a long time, but I would tell you, regularly, I find myself trying to do some part of my life on my own without God. And I need to repent. I need to change my mind about who the Father is, what the King is like, what following Him and doing it His way is like. So I just ask you a few questions this morning. Is there some area of your life where you're trying to do it on your own without God? Might there be something you need to change your mind or repent of today? Do you need to change your mind about who the King is and what He is like? See, because the main thrust of these parables is to teach us what the King is like. Is He a tyrant king? Watching, waiting for you to slip up so He can bring the hammer down on you? No. He's like a shepherd that would leave 99 and go after the one. Doesn't matter to Him that He's still got 99. His heart is for the one. He's like a woman. The King is like a woman who has 10 coins and loses one and sweeps the house and searches everywhere to find it. The King is like a father who loves his sons and daughters and will do anything to demonstrate that love to them except violate their own free choice to be in the relationship. The heart of our King is the heart of the Father in this last story. Listen to the verbs, just quickly, I'll list them off. These are the things the Father did. He divided His wealth when He was asked. He saw His son from a long way off. He felt compassion. He ran. He embraced. He kissed. He brought the best robe. He put the family ring back on his finger and shoes on his feet. He said, "Kill the fatted calf. We're throwing a huge party." He completely reinstated His son. And then when He found out that the other son wouldn't come in, He left the house again and went after this son that was lost. And He pleaded with him. Comforted him, urged him, "Child, please change your mind. Come into the party." Unconditional love shown to both sons. This is the King who invites us, you and I, into His kingdom today. He says, "Come be with me, and all that is mine will be yours." So will you repent? Change your mind about whatever it is you need to and accept His invitation into the kingdom? I hope so. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are like this father in this story. That you love every single person who has been created unconditionally, and you did not leave us. You sought after those who are lost, and you sent Jesus. And Jesus, thank you for coming, for living, for teaching us about your Father, for dying, for rising again, for ascending, and then thank you for sending the Holy Spirit, who comes to tell us what we need to repent of and to lead us into the kingdom. Lord, I pray that you would direct us, individuals, us here today, into the ways that we need to repent and what life is like in your kingdom. Help us to follow you. We pray in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's all stand as we respond.
We do need you to lead us into your kingdom. And pray you would send us out with this blessing from your word, from Romans 15. May you, God, the God of hope, the King, may you fill us up with joy and fill us up with peace so that our believing lives may be filled up with the life-giving energy of the Holy Spirit and then will brim over with hope. Go with God. He longs to go with you. Amen. Thank you.
happy.